So, Genji here on the edge with the 2-0 lead. So final game, or like final match point if you want. Again, Xylas Renekton bans. Why? Why? It's not a good... Like Xylas is not even remotely a good champion. He has no items to build. His keystones are also not optimal. The matchups are not good. Like, he's not good against the like hyper AD carries that we see regularly. It's just like what is this? Renekton, I don't have him. Like, no, everyone knows. And Jinx, I think Jinx is fine. Like, Jinx is not an issue, but an issue is that Kalista is not banned. And yes, Kalista is not OP, but you are on blue side. You can ban more for enemy comfort. Why are you not doing that? Seraphine ban on red side, so this is fine. This time, Genji can ban her and not get flamed. And these others, like, I mean, it's the same ban, so like, why change it up, right? T1 clearly doesn't really know what to do, so like, these bans don't do anything like good for them, so that's good. Means Udyr, Thresh, Senna, Kalista, again champions that should not really be so freely available, are on the table. Udyr first pick, so at least, yeah, with Hecarim gone, T1 will get the better jungle matchup. Genji handshakes it with the Olaf, which is, so already T1 is in a 5 versus 4 advantage. That's good for them. Kalista. So Olaf, Kalista. Already we know Genji is on the clock. Genji wants mid-game, early game aggression. Genji wants to play around bot side. T1 knows this. So what's the answer? Jace, Zoe. Okay, now you might ask yourself, does this make sense? Absolutely not. So this is like, I will go into a bit more detail about drafting. So if you're drafting, like, you want to like match picks, so like this is jungle, this is jungle, so you match jungle, right? And then you want to get like contested or OP picks, which the Kalista maybe is. I mean, Teddy is also a good Kalista player, right? And like Udyr maybe is like here the contested slash OP pick. And you want to then you want, if possible, flex picks, so the enemy can't, like I talked about matching, right? So if this is a flex pick, T1 wouldn't know how to answer that, right? These are like some like minor things. So but even if we exclude the drafting theory behind this, like, this is just oof. So first of all, Udyr Jace, Not amazing. Udyr Zoe, also not amazing, right? Udyr goes in, these two want to stand here. Again, like, what? Then, these two are like, they're your solo laners. So, they give you the pressure for the entire of the top jungle and the, yeah, part of the river here, right? So, with these being so vital for your map control, these matchups in bot, in mid and top have to be winning, right? So how do you secure winning matchups? By blind picking them? I don't think so. So again, why do you match, right? Why is matching a thing? You match jungle, right? Because you don't show what you have in hand. You don't show your plans. You don't show your lanes, because obviously, like, if you pick AD carry here, then the enemy can pick a better AD carry here, right? A counter. Simple, right? If you pick top lane and mid lane here, they can counter top lane and mid lane in the next stages. And the point is, T1 didn't have to do this, right? They could match AD carry here with an AD carry pick. And then I would recommend flexing here, because then they can't really counter pick here. Counter, yeah, sorry. They can't counter, right? Because there's a flex pick. But this way, you expose everything in your strategy, because, right, you show that you want to poke, you show that you want to play early mid game, so you handshake Genji's idea here, and already show these champions, which are not OP, so you can't blind pick them, right? We already saw last game that counters exist to these champions. Last game you counterpicked yourself in a way, and now you leave yourself open to get countered. So obviously this Zion is the response against Jace Udyr. Like they can't dive him. They can't really like pressure him too much. And again, I repeat myself, Zion just needs 1200 gold and Jace is not really moving him anywhere. Like, and again, in later stages, like Jace can't really split push. Yes, he can take towers. But yeah, well, can he take towers? Remember, split pushing doesn't work. Why does split pushing not work anymore? Because yeah, people have realized there's an item that is called One Mox Armor. So if Jace approaches like a bot lane wave here in the split push scenario, Zion positions here, he tanks damage, just Qs the wave, right? Ws, like gets the shield, ease a minion away, whatever, like thins out the wave or clears the wave entirely. Jace attacks his HP pool, so his HP pool goes down, right? But then, yeah, One Mox kicks in, and well, his HP pool is full again, and the next wave comes in, and that's a repeat, right? It's a basic strategy that like, nearly everyone knows right now. So, like, even in these stages, when Jace has the armor penetration and so on, it's not a great matchup. And we also, like, we saw in the game in the first one and in this one, so that's a bit of a spoiler, but Jace is going for the standard Jace build that he's, like going against every matchup, right? It's the Eclipse into the Muramana. But, like, I don't know really how this works out. I have not practiced it too much. But what about Jace going Black Cleaver into the Zion? So, normal Jace build would be two items and then you go for the Surrealer's Grudge. Which, against Surrealer's Grudge, I don't really think that's, like, dealing more damage. Personally, I think the 5% more armor penetration and the 15% bonus damage against champions with more health is like super effective against Zion. So obviously Jace with his item build is looking to poke the mid laner and the AD carry, but yeah, again, very very strange. In the next ban phase, so continuing with that aspect, Orianna set, so set again with Kalista, so that's, I guess, yeah, it's good. The Orianna here, you could argue that this should just be Syndra, and I would agree mostly, but the Orianna could turn Olaf into a champion, so T1 would lose their, oh well, now it's a 4v5, so now it's a 4v4, because Olaf doesn't exist and Jace doesn't exist. These are champions that like don't exist in the game. They just take XP and take gold away from their team. So now it's a 4v4. And Orianna may have turned Olaf into half a champion, so that would be their advantage. But again, I think like Syndra is the easier option here. But the discussion about Orianna or Syndra here doesn't really matter, because already you have a huge problem with this. And both matchups, Orianna or Syndra, are like at least somewhat favorable in against the Zoe. On the other side, picking away like defensive supports that are also very good for carrier. So why are defensive supports picked away? Because Zion already like as an engage source lacked it, and T1 with their squishy and like very soft team of poke champions, they would need some defensive capabilities to again withstand the engage of a Kalista ult and the Zion ult. So yeah, taking these away, already yeah, nice for them. Again, Syndra comes in, nothing too special, we already talked a bit about it. T1's next issue here is the bot lane, Samira Rell. So Rell obviously a good champion, she offers much for engage, and yeah, on theme with Udyr, but not on theme with Zoe and Jace. So T1 again has the issue, someone to stand here, someone to stand there. What's your idea here? Next issue is Carrier is not a good Rell player, actually. Or like, not very successful with her. I think he even has a negative win rate with her. So, it's not a super comfortable champion he is on. So, that's the next issue. But the Rell is the smaller issue, the bigger issue is Samira. So, on my research for this draft here, I saw that Teddy was practicing Samira in solo queue. But yeah, you in solo queue, it's like not pro play, right? Samira with her snowbally Katarina-esque playstyle. Does work in solo queue from time to time, with less organization, with less communication and so on. She can pop off and be effective. But again here, going in into Olaf, going in into Sion, not too great, and with the W nerfs, it's also much harder to play against Syndra. If it's harder, it's not impossible, but it's harder. And yeah, she also wants to go in, so yeah, T1 continues with like that team comp and identity being stretched thinner and thinner. They're further on the clock, right? Jace needs to snowball hard, Samira needs to snowball hard to be relevant in the mid game, and yeah, in late game she's also kinda meh. And yeah, Zoe is just along for the ride. Again, what is this? Like, it's like, has no clear identity, has no clear power spikes, especially no power spikes or no power that they can use, right? Jace always losing against Sion. He's not winning. He's getting pressure, but he's not winning. It's not a winning matchup. It's a pressuring matchup. He gets 20 CS up, but Sion needs like 3000 gold less in his build than Jace. So doesn't matter. Samira against Kalista. It's not even a good matchup for the bot lane. And we don't even see the support. And it's not like Rell has no counter picks. Jaragas, Alistar do exist. So again, losing bot lane, mid lane losing, top lane, yeah, Jace will stand here and like push in the waves the entire time because freezing doesn't exist in pro play, or at least in LCK. So yes, he has pressure and he can like pressure this area. But yeah, so what? So what? You get Herald, so you might get like Herald and Snowball Jace. But this is also not too reliable, because Sion has the free back with his ultimate. And Syndra will always have first roam. Ah, and bot lane also. Like support, that's the relevant thing, right? Support, like bot lane will get first chaff. So support will always have like not 20 seconds, but 10 seconds maybe advantage for roams. So again, T1 needs to win early game, but they don't really win early game because they don't have winning lanes. They don't win team fights because their team comp identity doesn't really match, and the champions are also behind from the laning phase. So again, at all fronts, T1 is just losing. It's like super terrible. Like look at all these drafts, winning, losing lanes, losing lanes, losing lanes. Like, what are you doing? Like, how can you draft 9 losing lanes in these 3 hours? It's just super mind-boggling. Obviously these are like pro coaches and so on, and the players are also giving in their intake, so it's hard to like exactly say who is at fault here for this. But I mean, the coaches do have the like voice of authority, so if like, I don't know, Kana is saying, yeah, I want to play Jace right now, then you have to say, shut the fuck up, no, Jace is terrible here, right? Like, you also have the blue side to the top lane, so you can even like make more use of Gangplank or something like that. Overall, again, it's mind-boggling how this can happen. Genji, yeah, in the game, Genji make use of their draft advantages, they played around their strengths. So yeah, they did a good job, and the T1 players, yeah, their farming abilities was good. Macro also was like not catastrophic, that was decent. But if you're like set out from the start too loose, because you have no legs to stand upon in like any stage of the game, you lose early, then you like that translates into a losing mid game, and like you might argue, okay, your 2-item power spikes are good. But if the enemy has like 2.5 items, then you might actually like just lose out. And again, T1's comps are also super hard to play, right? Poke comps are not easy to play. And so here, game one, game two, poke comp. Like game three, also poke comp. So like, is that a salty run back? Is that like... something like that really worries me for long term, because it means that they weren't even able to identify the issue of their play or the issue of their comp or the game. They were probably looking at like, oh yeah, if we didn't do that rotation, or if Clit didn't steal that rift herald, then we would have won. No, no, absolutely not. It's like, it's always easy to say, yeah, the draft were just bad and that's the reason why they lost. But if on this high level of play, where it's not outplays really, it's not really major missteps, right? Against the Dragon X series, you saw that T1 was able to win with bad drafts because the player gap was so real and the macro was just so off. But if you have players on similar power level, right? Like, just because Teddy and Carry are so good, they're not just rolling over Rule Alive with a like worse matchup. That's not going to be the case. And BDD is also super strong. Like, he's not going to like let Faker do his Faker things just with a bad matchup. And similar story in top and mid and jungle. Like, Genji is not a team that has like super weak players, right? Even though they're not super high in solo queue, Genji's players are super strong. And they have, as a team, worked together so long as well. So, like, it's not something where you can say, yeah, we're outmarkering, then we're just better, we outlane them. No, you can't just say that. On such a high level of play, with both teams being so potent, to just assume that you're going to outplay them with worse champions is just super strange. Right? If two people are like running against each other or whatever, like, and one guy has shoes and the other one doesn't, then obviously like the one with better equipment will win. And in League of Legends it's a similar story. Like, if both teams are like, if we say they are equally good, right? Or if the difference in skill is not too great in the key areas, then sure, the one with better equipment, with better setup, with better gear will win. It's just simple as that. But anyway, to stop you all from molding with me, we will get a banger series. Like, Genji with their drafts were really good. Damwon Kia had good drafts. So yeah, the final from the LCK will really be good. Both teams are like have skilled players in all positions. Both teams are good at team fighting. Yeah, I love it. So drafts will also be good. Like, I don't expect to see any Renekton bullshit. Yeah. So let's look all forward to that. See you then. And again, I might do a like how to draft video in between, so we can further talk about the tiny details of why T1's drafts and picks, even at these certain spots, don't really make any sense. Till then, I wish you all a great day. Yeah. Stay safe, maybe smile a bit. Bye.